Hello everybody, welcome to this last session of the VetBACT lecture. Today I will demonstrate how you can use VetBACT Lab for virtual experiments. It should be a complement to real experiments, but maybe this will be very useful for you to try before you start with your real experiments. So to reach that module, you have to scroll down here to course material and click on bacteriology course here. And here you find also the quizzes as we talked about during the last session. But here we go now to VetBACT Lab. Click on here. And here you can see that I have used an old account to log in. If you want to use VetBACT Lab, you need an account, and if you contact us and tell you a little why you are interested in performing this experiment and your background, we will probably be able to send you login data. Here on the start page for VetBACT Lab, you can have information about how you should proceed with the different experiments you can do here. But I cannot go through everything here because it's rather much. So this you should read yourself when you start an experiment. What I will do now, I will try to guide you through the different experiments here. And you see you have 12 different cases in diagnostic veterinary bacteriology, and you have six food samples, which you also can analyze. You can also see here that for students which speak Chinese, there are some information also for them. I will select case number two here and go through it so you can see how you should proceed. So here we have a disease history, and we have some information about the case. It's a horse and it's a filly. The age is 4 months, and you have got lung tissue. And if you read this, you can see that the filly died, in fact, and the pathological anatomical diagnosis was pneumonia. And now it is your task to try to find out which bacterium caused this disease. So if you scroll down here, you will see what sample you get and some information about it. It's a piece of lung tissue. And here you have to first decide what you want to do with this lung tissue. And you have different alternatives to choose between. Either you can take the sample from an inner part of the piece of tissue and streak it onto FAA agar, that is fastidious anaerobic agar. And if you click on FAA plate here, you will get more information about what kind of plate it is if you by chance don't know it. You can another alternative is that you streak the sample onto blood agar and purple agar and incubate at 37, or you can take a sample from the surface of the tissue. So now with the background you have, you should be able to know what would be the best in this case, and you should not use a plate for anaerobic cultivation because lung tissue is not very anaerobic, it's rather very aerobic. And also it's not good to take from the surface because it may be contaminated by other bacteria. So the best is to take some sample from the inner part of the tissue. So let's answer here and submit this answer. That was correct, that you should take from the inner part and spread it on blood agar and on purple agar. And now, since it is virtual experiments you have to do, you should just click here and you will get the bacteria streaked onto the plates. And here you see how it will look, and if you have difficulties to see, you can enlarge the picture here. and see that you have a number of colonies which are numbered here, and your purpose now is to select which colony you should take to work with further. And on the blood agar plate you see one colony here which is well separated from the others, and here you see colonies which are close to other colonies, and also here. So here it should be obvious that you should take colony number one. And from the purple agar you should see here that colony number five is well separated from other colonies. Number six and number four are closer to others. So the correct answer is probably number one and number five. But let's select something else here and see what happens. Let's select three and six instead and see what will happen. And then you see, of course, that this was not the correct answer. And you get another chance to select the right one. And now you can maybe see that the questions come in different order here. But here you can select 1 and 5 instead and submit the answer. And that was correct. And what you now have to do is to streak these two colonies, 1 and 5, on another blood agar plate to compare them with each other and to check if they are the same. So you have the plate here and you streak them by clicking on this link. And now you see that the plate is divided into two parts, and on the part A here you have the colonies from the blood agar, and on part B you have from the purple agar. And if you inspect these colonies carefully you will probably see that there are no difference in appearance between the colonies on the part A and the part B. So that means that you can take any of these colonies. Take that away. So use any clearly defined colony directly for biochemical and other tests. That is the alternative you should choose here, and submit the answer. And you see that was correct, and you will get some further information about your result here. And now you can come into the other part of the virtual experiment, namely the toolbox. And to get the toolbox, you have to click on the link here. Now you have the toolbox to the left here with the different tools you can choose. You can also see here a summary of the completed tests you have done. You have streaked one blood agar plate and one purple agar plate to a price of 2.60 euros. So there is a time stamp and a cost stamp on each tool here, which will allow you to see how long time and what was the cost of your experiment. And the task is to try to do this as cheap as possible and as fast as possible, but you have to be absolutely sure. It must be a safe diagnosis that you come up with in the end. But now it's not possible to decide what bacteria it is from the tests you have done, so you have to do some additional tests here. And if, for instance, you don't know what kind of test it is, you can get the information by clicking on the tool, olfactory tool, for instance. You get the information about that here. It is very simple. It is your own nose, so you should try to feel the smell of the bacterium, if it has a characteristic smell or not. So that is, in some cases, a very good tool. So I think we choose that. It is cheap also. And blood agar, you see it's gray here, so that you have done already. Purple agar is gray also, so you have done it. But we have to choose some standard tests here to be able to say what it is. Gram staining has to be done. And perhaps catalase test, and perhaps also the oxidase test. We should, of course, not choose all the tests here, because then it will become too expensive. So we should start with these four tests and see what result we get. And let's run the tests here. And it will take some times here, proportional to the real time it takes, but to make you feel that all tests take certain time. Now it's ready and you can view the results here. And let's go down and check. Olfactory tool, you get some information here that is some strange smell from the bacteria, described as smell of underground cellars, old stumps or rotten pier, which is in fact in this case characteristic for these bacteria. Let's see what happened with the other test. Here we see the agar plates, which we have already performed. But down here you can see the result of the gram staining. You can see that it is gram positive, and maybe you will also see that it is not really coccoid and not really rods either, so something in between, coccoid rods or coccobacillar. You go down a little more, you see the result of the catalase test. You have the negative control here, the positive control here. So your sample was positive in the catalase test. And the oxidase test, you see positive control, negative control, and your sample was negative in the oxidase test. So then you can summarize your results by filling in your notebook here. It was gram positive and coccoid rods, and also it was catalase positive and oxidase negative. And also, I think we should remember the characteristic smell. And then we can save the notes. And maybe you already suspect what bacteria this could be, but probably it is still a guess, but I think it could be worthwhile to make a guess already now. So then you should select the correct species from the list here, and it's a list of all bacteria that you can find in VetBACT. And since it is a foal, and since you have the result of gram staining, you may suspect that this could be Rhodococcus equi. So let's select Rhodococcus equi. I don't know if that is really absolutely sure. It could perhaps be something else, but you want to take a chance here to say Rhodococcus equi and submit the diagnosis. So here we get some feedback. It's a reasonable guess, but there are some additional tests that have to be done also. For instance, you should perform the urease test. Aha, let's do that. So let's scroll down here to the different tests, and we select also the urease test here and run that. So we have to wait here a little, and then we can view the results and see what happened with the urease test. Go down here, and here you can see a negative control, a positive control, and your sample. It is really urease positive, and that confirms the identification as Rhodococcus equi. So let's go down to the lab, and submit the diagnosis once again. And look here on the list. You see here that the last test here is amygdalin fermentation. But now we submit the diagnosis again, and you will see what happens in the list. Have Rhodococcus equi here, and submit the diagnosis. So now you see that you have done a correct identification and you have done it with the correct tests that have to be done according to the standard in Swedish laboratories. And let's go down here and see what has happened here. Ah, now you have another test here which you can choose. You can use 16S rRNA sequencing as an alternative method. We haven't introduced that from the beginning because it's a very expensive test and most people prefer perhaps to identify these bacterium without being this expensive test. But if you really want to confirm your diagnosis, you can do it, and I will show you here how you do it in the virtual experiment. You select then 16S RNA sequencing. You perform the test. It will take longer time than the other tests, so we have to wait a little here until we can get the result. And in the meantime, we can see that so far the cost has been 4.80 euros, which is not so expensive, but it will be more expensive when we add the 16S rRNA sequencing. And now the sequencing is finished. In fact, it takes, of course, much longer time than that. So then we can view the result here. And how will the result appear here? Well, we have to go to the bottom of the result. And here we have the sequences. The sequence, I should say. It's, of course, only one sequence. And here you have also information about how you should proceed with the sequence. You should go to another website called the National Center of Biotechnology Information, and you can find the way to handle the sequence here, and we'll follow that. So the first thing we do is that we copy the whole sequence. Oh, I got a little too much. Go from here and the case there. And I copy it, then I go to NCBI here. So now we are connected to the database in the United States, where we also have GeneBank, where all sequences which has been determined in literature has been stored. And we will use a program called BLAST, which is a program which compares your sequence with the sequences that you can find in this database. And now we should see here, we have to scroll down a little, and we should have the nucleotide BLAST we select, and here we add our sequence. I just glue it in here. Here we have the sequence, and if I want to have a title of my job, I get it automatically here, case number 2. And I check here that it is the nucleotide collection which will be used for comparison, and others here is also correct. Then I start the comparison, and now our sequence will be sent to the database in the United States, so it will take some time here, and it will be compared with the sequences which they have in the database, which is several hundred million sequences or positions at least. So it will definitely take some time, but not too long, I hope. And here we have already the result. Now our sequence has been compared to a great number of sequences in the database. And first we have a graphic representation of the comparison. And you can see here that all sequences are in red, which means that they are highly similar with the sequence that we have contributed to with. And you see here on top we have a sequence which is very, very similar and which also have about the same length as the sequence we have submitted. But this is not what we want to see, but we are also interested in the list down here. And on top of this list, you will find Rhodococcus equi. And that is the most similar sequence. And you can see here that the sequence similarity is 100%. And there are several strains of Rhodococcus equi, which also are highly similar to our sequence. So now I think we are sure that we have done a correct identification of the bacterium. So then I think we can go back to VetBact Lab here and go down to the list again. And now I also want at least to start the demonstration of how a food sample should be handled. And I select sample number 2, also in this case, soft ice cream, an interesting kind of sample which can contain a lot of different bacteria. Also here we have case description in both Swedish and in Chinese, but of course for this purpose here today in English. So here we have first some information about the sample, and your task is to find out which bacteria this sample contains. And here you already get information about the different testing parameters, or in other words, the bacteria which should be looked for, and at which dilutions. And from this information here, you should be able to say how many dilution tubes you have to use. And from the information here, you should see that the sample has already been diluted once when you have prepared it and make the homogenization. So that means that in spite of the fact that you should dilute it till minus 6, you need only 5 dilution tubes. And that you can select here, 5 dilution tubes, and you submit the answer. And that was correct. Here you have your 5 dilution tubes, and now you have to decide which media you should use for the different testing parameters. And if you click here, you get a list of different media, and you should combine the different media with the correct bacterium. And for Enterobacteriaceae, for instance, here, the first parameter, you should use violet red bile glucose agar, which is substrate number 2 in this series. And for thermotolerant E. coli, you should have tryptophan soy agar, that is number 5 in this list. And for coagulase positive staphylococci, you should use the Bad Parker agar, which is number 8. The Bacillus cereus, you should use bovine blood agar, which is number 7. And for to make the total number of aerobic microorganisms, you should choose plate count agar. But let's choose something else. Let's choose, for instance, number 10, just to check what happens if you make a wrong answer. Submit the values here, and you can immediately see that this is not correct. You get a red label here on your answer. So then you get the chance to change it to instead substrate number 1, plate count agar, and let's try again. Yes, you see it's correct. And then you have to decide how you want to spread your bacteria and how you should incubate, at which temperature and at which atmospheric conditions. So Enterobacteriaceae first should be so-called deep spreading. You see the alternatives you have up here, deep spreading or surface spreading. So it should be deep spreading. And for thermotolerant coliform bacteria, you should also have deep spreading. And for staphylococci, you spread on the surface. Bacillus cereus also on the surface. And total number of aerobic microorganisms is also deep spreading. The incubation temperature, enterobacteriosis, gut needs 37 degrees. Thermotolerant coliform bacteria, thermotolerant E. coli, you should have chosen perhaps 37 also, but now we are interested in the thermotolerant variants of the coliform bacteria. So then we choose 44, and the staphylococci 37, like body temperature, Bacillus cereus 30 degrees, and finally total number of aerobic microorganisms, it's also 30 degrees. And the conditions for all these kind of testing parameters are aerobic. Like that, so then we submit the values. And now we have incubated the plates for 24 hours. You see we are already on the second day. We have our incubators here. And now the question is which bacteria should be red after 24 hours. Enterococcus, is it Enterococcus? No, probably not. I don't think we were going to analyze that testing parameter. How about aerobic microorganisms and coagulase positive staphylococci? No, they need a longer time. How about Bacillus cereus, enterobacteriaceae and the coliforms? Yes, I think that is the bacteria we should analyze after 24 hours. So let's submit the answer. Yes, it was okay, good choice. So here we put the bacteria in the incubator and start the incubation. And now we get the plate out of the agar and we should interpret it. You see, don't see any bacteria here, but if we enlarge the plate a little, we don't see any bacteria either. So here we know that we did a deep spreading, and that means that 1 milliliter of bacterial suspension was used, and this is dilution -1. So that means that it's a 10 times dilution, and then there must be at least 10 bacteria if you should have a chance to detect them. So what you can say now is that it is at least less than 10 bacteria, or rather colony forming units of the bacteria on the plate. So we submit that answer, and you see that was correct also. And let's just click on here to get the next parameters. And now I think that you can continue yourself with the experiment and make it final. So thank you very much for your attention, and good luck with your experiments. And if you liked it, please let us know by making a comment. You can do that in the form in the end. Or if you didn't like it, we also want to have a comment. So thank you very much.